origins of the place of Mecca, first of all. If you want to know about Mecca, we start with the life of Prophet Ibrahim, where we know that he was told to leave his wife and his son, Ismail and Hajar, in the place, in this desert place, effectively, with just a few days, and then the water was running out as well. We know his wife Hajar, alayhi salam, would run between Safa and Marwa, and that's when the baby would come and stamp on the ground, and the Zamzam water would come out. So when the water came out, the people saw this, they came, and they settled in that vicinity, and this was the origins of the place of Mecca. Yeah, so this is how the Mecca began, the town of Mecca, the people, this is how it started. Later on, Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam comes and he's commanded to build a house Al-Kaaba with his son Ismail alayhi salam. This is now we know how Mecca starts, how Al-Kaaba started as a place of worship. Okay? Then we continue. Shortly after that, or some generations after that, shirk starts to get introduced into Al-Kaaba. So even the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the place of Tawheed, has been polluted by shirk. There's a man called Amr bin Luhay, he goes to Syria. He sees the people there worshipping idols. So he brings an idol back there, people like it, other people bring idols, and then so much so, the whole of the Kaaba is overtaken by idols. And this man, Amr bin Luhay, he was a very likable person. He was like the leader of his people, he was respected. People said, he's doing it, we can do it as well. And this is how the shirk spread. So the danger is that sometimes, even when we like someone and we respect someone, when they go against the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's when we have to leave them. We don't obey them in disobedience to Allah. In this situation, his people, they obey him in disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is an important lesson here. So then we see how the Kaaba at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Kaaba was full of idolatry. So this was the religion of the Arabs of that time, of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They were idol worshippers predominantly. This was their religion. In terms of their ethics, and there were people, they drank a lot of alcohol, they gambled, they fought over the smallest thing. Yeah, they weren't beacons of society. Okay, they were weak, they were fragmented, all of these kind of things. If they had any good characteristics, they stuck to their covenants or their vows. Okay, they made a covenant or a promise, they stuck to it. They were known for their language, they commanded the Arabic language, something that they held on to very tightly. These were some of the qualities that they possessed. So then we started the lineage of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we begin by just to keep you engaged, asking you questions as we go along. So what is, who can tell me then the lineage to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is Muhammad bin Abdullah, and let's continue like that inshallah. So let's just see how far we can go. I've got the book so I can go quite far, so let's open up to the floor. So Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam bin Abdullah.
Abdullah.
Who's next?
Abdul
Muttalib, okay, yeah, next.
Hashim.
Bin Hashim. Yeah, okay, bin Hashim, and in brackets, Abu, fine, yeah. Next. Can we go past four generations? Anybody else? Bin Hashim, bin?
Adnan.
No, next, Abdul Manaf. Yes, Abdul Manaf, bin Qusay, bin Kilab, bin Murrah, bin Kaab, bin Noh, and then carries on like that, inshallah. Because this is the lineage of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, we begin by his great-grandfather, a man called Hashim. What was he known for? So what was Hashim known for? This man was known for something in particular. He did something that was different from what the rest of the Arabs did. Does anyone know where he got his name from, Hashim? What did he used to do? Yeah, he used to serve the pilgrims bread in broth, basically. So his first name was Amr, but he was called Hashim because he had been in the practice of crumbling bread for the pilgrims. Okay? This wasn't his full name. Hashim is not his proper name. He's given this name. Yes? Okay. This is a man called Hashim. One of the things that he does, he goes to Medina and he has a wife in Medina. So he's based in Mecca. That's right, we know this is where the story takes place. But he goes to Medina and he marries to he married a woman called Salma, the daughter of Amr from Bani Adi bin An-Najjar. So he marries in Medina. Yes? And then he has a son, and the name of his son is what? So Hashim has a son called?
Shayba.
Okay, what does Shayba mean?
Oh,
it says here, because he's got white hair basically, Shayba because of the white hair on his head. So even as a young baby, young child, he had white hair on his head. So he was called Shayba. But then sometimes later on he would be called the name Abdul Muttalib. So the grandfather of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is where? Where was the grandfather of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam born? Medina. Yeah, so you can see the link here. So later on you go through Sirah, and sometimes you wonder, why did the people of Medina respond so positively to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? One of the reasons was that there was a lineage of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is important. You know where we come from, you know you have somebody from your tribe or your village, and somebody else knows somebody, they've been in your village, they've got history, you know, their grandfather, their great-grandfather, you have a certain amount of respect for them. It's easier. And so this is why it's quite interesting how the people of Medina, one of the reasons they responded very, very quickly to the Prophet was that there was some family lineage, some family history there. Okay, then we go on. So Abdul Muttalib now is based in Medina. He's a young boy. His father passes away. His uncle then comes to Medina and takes this young boy back to Mecca to give him his responsibilities in Bani Hashim. Okay, he has an argument. Some of his uncles, they disagree with that. But anyway, he's established there. So Abdul Muttalib, he's the grandfather of the Prophet. He grows up. Okay, two significant incidents happen in his life. So Abdul Muttalib, when you read the seerah, many things happen, but two particularly significant things are mentioned about the life of Abdul Muttalib. What are these two things? Yes, brother.
The king came from the...
Yeah, okay, that's good.
Abraha.
Very good. And the other one?
Zamzam.
Okay, very good, mashallah. So, Abdul Muttalib, he has a dream to dig up a place called the Zamzam well, basically, this area. And this was inside this place. One of the previous tribes called Jurhum, when they had left Mecca, they had put all their gold and all their gold swords and two deers and all these kind of things in this place. It was all hidden, so nobody had it. Okay? He had this dream. The grandfather of the Prophet had the dream to go there, dig up this place. So he starts to dig it up, basically. Okay? And then Zamzam water starts to come out. This is very significant, as you know, all the Zamzam water. And the other thing is that as he's drinking it out, the people of Mecca, they come as well, and they say, we all want a share of the gold, basically. Makes sense? They said, we want to share the gold. He says, no. They said, they insisted on it. He only had one son. So in that time, in that tribal culture, if you have 10 sons that can support you, you're in a position of strength. But if you have one son or you have no son, then you're in a position of weakness. So he makes a dua to Allah. Because they remember, they did shirk, but they still believe in Allah amongst other gods as well. So he makes a dua that if I have 10 sons, I will sacrifice one of my sons because you've given me 10 sons, basically. Does that make sense? This is quite significant. So he has his son. He has 10 sons now. And who is the one who is going to sacrifice? Who's he going to sacrifice?
Abdullah,
yes. Who is the father of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay, so he's going to sacrifice him, but he's his favourite son. He doesn't want to sacrifice him, but because he said he's going to. So then what he does, they go to see a Susan, a young woman, a magician type person. She says, look, what you do, you have his name and you have like 10 camels. And you pull straws out basically. And if his name comes out, you have to sacrifice 10 camels. And you keep on going on until you no longer, you have to, until his name comes out. So they carry on like this until 100 camels have to be slaughtered, okay? So then he is saved from his vow, but he has to sacrifice 100 camels. Okay, so this is what he does, it's a huge amount, huge amount. And the meat is left anyway, this is the honor. And so the Prophet ﷺ says in a hadith later on, I am the offspring of the two slaughtered ones. Now we understand, I am the offspring of the two slaughtered ones. One of them is obviously Abdullah. Who's the other one?
Ismail.
Remember the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Okay, so this happens. So this is what happens. Then he marries, Abdullah marries Amina, the daughter of Wahb bin Abd Manaf, and they have a son, obviously Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is that. The other thing is that we see is that Abdul Muttalib was the leader of his tribe at that time. Okay. And so obviously, the Arabs, they have Al-Kaaba. Okay? The Christians, they wanted to compete with the Kaaba. Okay? So what they did in Yemen, viceroy in Yemen, he built a huge church, basically. Okay? So he wanted to attract the people. One of the Arabs, he got very angry. He got some excrement, some animal muck, and he put it on the walls of the church. You can imagine the king is going to get very, very angry. So he spent all this money, all this, you know, and this is what he insults. It's like, put all that effort has gone to nothing because he's humiliated in such a manner. If you can imagine, he gets a huge army and he's going to bring his army to destroy the Kaaba. And this is a huge army, it's a huge army. And we know the story that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends the birds with the little bits of clay, basically, the pebbles, and they come and they destroy all the elephants, which Al-Fil is revealed. And this is the year in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is born. But these are two significant things that happened in the life of Abdullah bin Muttalib. We continue and we go to the birth of Rasulullah ﷺ, and it said he was born in Bani Hashim in Mecca on Monday morning, the 9th of Rabiul Awwal, the same year of the elephant incident. Sometimes people differ on the exact date, but this is what's mentioned in this book. Then it's reported that certain things, when he was born, there was a light that came out that lit the palaces of Syria. There was 14 balconies of Kisra's palaces that collapsed. the Medjin sacred fire went out and some churches on the lake collapsed as well. And it's recorded al-Bayaki, al-Tabari. So some authentic sources authenticate these kind of things happen. So the birth of Rasulullah marked very significant things that happened in the world. You can imagine he's the master of mankind. So he's a young boy, and just at his birth, just before or after, his father passes away. So he's an orphan at a very young age. Okay? So one of the first things that happens is that many of the richer or the well-off families, they would send their children off to the desert, basically, to the tribes. Why? So they could be, you know, there's fresh air, they become stronger, and they learn the pure Arabic language. Okay? So all the women, they would come down, and they would take a child. But no one would take this child. Why? Because obviously his father's passed away. So the person who takes a child, they get the payment from the father. Now there's no father here, obviously, so no one wants to have this baby. But there's a lady called Halima, she takes a young boy, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she says, "It was a year of drought and famine, and we had nothing to eat. I rode on a brown mule. We also had with us an old she-camel. By Allah, we could not even get a drop of milk. We could not have a wink of sleep during the night, for the child kept crying because of hunger. There was not enough milk in my breast, and even the she-camel had nothing to feed him. We used to constantly pray for rain and immediate rain. We used to constantly pray for rain and immediate relief. At length we reached Mecca, there was an orphan and I took him in." So she's in a very bad situation. Nothing is going right for her, neither her animals, neither her baby, neither her health, everything is bad. She says, "I don't want to take an orphan," but then she took him. She says, when I went with him, I lifted him in my arms and returned to my place. I put him on my chest, and to my great surprise, I found enough milk in it. He drank to his heart's content, and so did his foster brother, and both of them went to sleep, although my baby had not been able to sleep the previous night." So again, a barakah, a blessing has come. She says that when she came back into the villages away from Mecca, she said when she came, her animal was the slowest one. When she came back, she was like ahead of everybody else. He said that even where her animals would go and feed on the ground, the grass would come. So in every sense, when she took the Prophet ﷺ back to herself, barakah came into her life. This is the blessing of Rasulullah ﷺ, even before prophethood has come. So it's very important to know the significant things that happen before prophethood. So this is one thing that happens. Then another significant thing that happens at that time is what? What's some of the significant things that happens to Halima when she has the young boy Muhammad ﷺ with her? What's some of the significant thing that happens? I want some one of the person. What's the significant thing? We go to this side of the room, inshallah.
Me.
I don't know, so it's not fair numbers, it's 61 or 63, but anyway. Anybody, what else happens?
Jibreel alayhi salam.
Jibreel alayhi salam, exactly. So she says that her son comes and says that Muhammad has been killed, basically. Okay, so they go there, and it's authentically reported by Anas in Sahih Muslim that Jibreel alayhi salam came down, opened his chest and took out his heart. There was extracted a blood clot out of it and said, "This was the pot of shaitan in you." Then he washed it with the water of Zamzam in a gold basin. After that, the heart was joined together and restored to its place. The boys came running. They said, "Verily, Muhammad Sassam has been murdered." They all rushed out. They found him. He was okay. His face was white. Anas said, "I have seen the mark that was left on his chest." So again, another evidence of this incident happened at the time of the Prophet Sassam. He's returned back to his mother, okay, he's returned back to his mother Amina, and she decides to visit Yathrib or Medina. Medina is used to call Yathrib. She sets out on a journey with her orphan boy, her father-in-law Abdul Muttalib, and a woman servant called Ayman. She spends a month there on a place called Abwa on the way back from Mecca to Medina. She passes away. So now the Prophet ﷺ is a young boy of 5 or 6. His father's passed away and his mother's passed away. You know, this is a tribal culture. It's not like here, it's very difficult, very hard. He's looked after by his grandfather, Abdul Muttalib. He looks after him. He very much honors him. You'd like, outside the Kaaba, you'd have a place to sit on, basically, okay? He wouldn't allow anybody else to come and sit on that place. But when Muhammad ﷺ would come, he would allow him to sit on it. So really, he honored his grandson. He said he used to seat the boy on his mattress, pat his back, and was always pleased with what the boy did. So Abdul Muttalib had a very special place in the heart for this young boy, Muhammad ﷺ. Another tragedy, then his grandfather passed away when Rasulullah ﷺ was approximately the age of 8 years and 2 months. Then he was looked after by whom? Who's the next person to look after him?
Muttalib.
Abu Talib looks after him. And he remained with him, looking after his nephew as much as he can, inshallah. Then we come on, the next important thing in Sirah is the incident of Bahira. Okay, Bahira is a monk basically. So the Prophet ﷺ is a young boy, the age of 12. He goes with his uncle on a trade journey to Syria. As they're going there is a monk called Bahira, and he comes out and he says, takes Muhammad ﷺ by the hand and says, "This is the master of all human beings." Very powerful statement, it's not something small. "This is the master of all humans. Allah will send him with a message which would be a mercy to all people." Abu Talib said, "How do you know that?" He said, "When you appear from the direction of Aqaba, all stones and trees did sujood, and they never do sujood except to a prophet. I also recognize him by the seal of prophethood, which is below his shoulder like an apple. We have found this in our books. Take him back, do not take him to Syria with the Jews, they may harm him," basically. So again, so another evidence that this child will grow up to be a very special person, basically. This is the early part of the life of Rasulullah. We continue. His early occupation, that he was a shepherd basically, so very humble type of work. And at the age of 25 or so, he married Khadija radiallahu anha. So this was his first wife. She was very impressed. Basically, she hired him first of all. He went on a trade journey for her. Okay, she went back. She spoke to one of her servants called Maisara, and he said that this young man, he is the most honourable. He never cheats. He never lies. He's so much barakah and whatever he does. Everything about him is good. She's very impressed by that. She can marry anyone. She's very rich. She can marry anyone in Mecca, but she chooses him. And though she is 15 years of his senior, he accepts to marry her, and he's married to Khadija radiallahu anha. And they're married together, and with her, he has all of his children, Al-Qasim, Zainab, Ruqayya, Khultum, Fatima, Abdullah, who was called Tayyib and Tahir. All the sons died in their childhood, and all the daughters except Fatima radiallahu anha died during his lifetime. It's very difficult. Six children for five of them to pass away. One child dies for a person. This is huge. This is great. You see someone, their child dies, you don't see that person the same again. It's huge. But for five to die, subhanAllah, this is a huge, sometimes we overlook how much of difficulty this was. Okay. The next thing, one of the final things then before prophethood begins, was his rebuilding of the Kaaba and the arbitration basically. So Quraysh, they decided to rebuild Al-Kaaba. Okay, so this Kaaba has been rebuilt a number of times throughout history. So the Kaaba, they decide to rebuild it, so they built it all, etc. And then they get to the most difficult thing, or the most important thing, which is replacing the black stone onto the wall of the Kaaba. And every tribe wants to do this. So now they're all going to go to war over this issue. Remember what we said at the beginning, one of the things about the Arabs was that they would go to war over small things. This is quite a big thing for them, a huge thing, that black stone is so important, they're going to go to war. They say that whoever walks in basically, we're going to ask him to decide. Muhammad ﷺ walks in and everyone is delighted because they know of his wisdom and his fairness. Again, he's very wise. He puts a sheet out, he puts a stone on the sheet. He says to the leaders, all of you come to one side, so you're all sharing and bringing the stone, and I will place it back onto the wall of the Kaaba. Extremely wise. Everyone is, his face is saved in front of his tribe. He has participated, he's equal to everybody else. And Muhammad said, we love him, we chose him, he's the one who walked, he can put it back. It's fair enough, basically. So this was again shows the wisdom of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So to conclude, he was the most, before prophethood, he was the most distinguished amongst his people for his modesty, virtuous behavior, and graceful manners. These things count for a lot. And nowadays, it's all about wealth and all the big car. It's not. When you really rank a person, modesty, good behavior, and graceful manners, these things are priceless things. Priceless things. He proved himself to be the ideal of manhood and to possess a spotless character. He was the most obliging to his friends, the most honest in his talk, and the mildest in temper. He was the most gentle-hearted, chaste, and hospitable. He always impressed people by his piety-inspiring expressions. He was the most truthful and the best to keep covenant. His fellow citizens all gave him the title of Al-Amin. So this is what they said about him. This was before prophethood. You can just imagine how he's going to be. If someone's the best before prophethood, then it's just going to be amazing when the prophethood comes to him. But this was his character. Then we move on to the next stage where the prophethood begins. We'll start covering this, inshallah. So one of the things that the Prophet ﷺ would do, he would go to a cave. What's the name of the cave? Cape Hira. Yeah, he would go there, and it was a small cave, four arms length by two arms length. It's not long at all, basically. And on the way, he would give food to the poor. If there was anybody, he would always go there, feed any poor people who came to him. And he would go there, and he would just think about the dunya, think about what's going on in the world, all the injustices, basically. And the person who reflects, you know, meditate, reflect, these kind of things. It was a rich period of privacy, which lasted for 3 years prior to the beginning of his mission. Then the Shaykh continues, when he was 40, the peak of one's life. You know, 40 is when a person becomes mature, a person becomes a man. Some of us are beyond that now, but 40 is when they say that you really become, you're the best, you've still got some health, you've got wisdom as well, you've got strength, you've probably been working for a while. 40 is really, you know, mashallah, is the peak of one's life. And they say it is the age when prophets were always ordered to disclose their message. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, amongst his signs were the stones in Mecca would greet him with salam. He would not have a dream except that it would become reality as clear as dawn. This lasted for 6 months. And for 6 months, anything that he would dream about, it would come true. This was a period of prophet of 23 years. It continues, and the angel came to him and said, Iqra, recite. The prophet said, I cannot recite. This happened a number of times, and then we know as soon as Iqra, the first few ayat was revealed. Read in the name of your Lord who has created man from a clot, read, and your Lord is the most generous. The Prophet ﷺ repeated these verses, but he was very frightened. He doesn't know. Now, in hindsight, we know what's going on. But you imagine the Prophet ﷺ being in that situation, an angel is coming to him, he's being told to read, these words have been, he really does not know what is going on. He comes back to his wife, Khadija, and he says, cover me. He's very frightened, he doesn't know. And again, he doesn't go to his uncle, he doesn't go to the leaders of Mecca, he goes to his wife. It shows, you know, the wisdom of Khadija radhiyallahu anha, and it shows the relationship that they have. She says to him, Allah will never disgrace you. You maintain uterine relations, you know, between your relatives. You bear the burden of the weak, you help the poor and the needy, you entertain the guests, and you ensure hardship in the path of truthfulness. It's very beautiful, very beautiful. You know, whose wife would say that to them? You're good to your relatives, you help your guests, you feed the poor, you're amazing, no way, nothing's wrong with you. Very great. Just immediately what she said, immediately. This was his way. Then she said, okay, let's go and see my cousin, and what's the name of the cousin? Walid bin Nawfal, okay? He was a Christian, he embraced Christianity in the pre-Islamic period. He was an old man. Khadija said, my cousin, listen to your nephew. Waraka said, oh my nephew, what did you see? Allah's Messenger told him, Waraka replied, this is Namas, brackets, the angel who is entrusted with divine secrets that Allah sent to Musa, alayhi salam. I wish I were younger, I wish I could live up to the time when your people would drive you out. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, will they drive me out? This is astonishing as well. Because remember, tribal culture, in your tribe, even if your person does something wrong, he's your tribe, you're going to protect them with your blood basically. Especially Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, remember what he said? Remember that incident of the Kaaba, everyone loves him, it's impossible for them to drive him out. But this man is saying, Waraka is saying, I wish I was with you when they drive you out. He says, will they drive me out? Waraka said, anyone who has come with something similar to what you have brought was treated with hostility, and if I should be alive till then, I would support you strongly. So Waraka said, I would support you, but he tells him, this is the path of hardship. This is Islam. You know, it's difficult, it's hardship, challenge, giving dawah especially. It's not an easy task, but something we have to do. A few days later, Walaka died and revelation paused for a small while. It came again. And then the Prophet ﷺ would go out and he was given the responsibility of warning. O you, arise and warn, and your Lord, arise and your Lord magnify, and your garments purify, and keep away from ar-rijs or the idols. So now the Prophet ﷺ is commanded to go out and call the people to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He does so, and who are the first four people then that accept Islam? Who are the first four to accept Islam? Or the first, just the first few? Yes, brother?
Ali bin Talib.
Yeah, good. Anybody
else?
Very good, two. We mentioned one already. Who's the one that we mentioned?
Khadija.
Zayd. Yeah, Abu Bakr is there as well, yeah, fine. So it goes on. Zayd bin Haritha, he's like a slave of the Prophet that lived in the house of Rasulullah. A very interesting story. Later on, his father finds him basically, and the Prophet says to him, you can either stay with me or go to your father. Everyone will say, I want to go to my father. But this man says, having seen the Prophet, I'd rather stay with Rasulullah. So he's in the house of, immediately he becomes a Muslim. Ali bin Abi Talib, again, he was raised in the same house as the Prophet. and his best friend Abu Bakr and Khadija radhiyallahu anha. So Abu Bakr, all of these professed Islam on the very first day of the call. Amongst them all, it said, Abu Bakr was at the forefront of Dawah. You know, immediately, people like Uthman ibn Affan, Az-Zubayr ibn Awwam, Abdurrahman ibn Awf, Sa'd bin Abi Waqas, Talha bin Ubaydullah, you know, these were like these giants in Islam. Giants, and without exaggeration, they all accepted Islam at the hands of Abu Bakr radhiyallahu anhu. This is very important because he was known again for his truthfulness. He was known for his honesty, his truthfulness. People respected him. Many people, they accepted Islam. And amongst them, the Sheikh went on, there were 40 or so of the early Muslims. So these were amongst the 40 or so early Muslims. Does anyone know any names of the early ones? Anybody else? The very early Muslims?
Yes, sir.
Yes, okay. Who's then going to be tortured? Anybody else?
Ibrahim.
Who's sorry? Ibrahim?
Yes.
Bilal ibn Rabah, yeah, that's fine. There's a few others. One interesting one is the daughter of Al-Khattab, or the sister of Umar al-Khattab. This is quite interesting. That she accepted Islam very early on. Sorry?
Fatima.
Fatima, yeah, it's not mentioned yet, but I'm sure it was not mentioned specifically yet. Okay. Good. Okay. Then it goes on, and the question is raised that is Salah practiced by the Muslim at this time? Is Salah practiced? Interesting question, isn't it? The Salah we know is revealed, the five times Salah, Al-Isra al-Miraj in the Medina, obviously. But is Salah revealed at this time?
No.
Interesting. So, the Sheikh Ibn Hajar says, definitely the Prophet used to pray before the night journey. Okay? But it still remains a matter of controversy whether or not the prayers were established as an obligatory ritual before imposing the rules of the usual five prayers a day. So in some form, the Sultan used to pray, not the five prayers as we know, but in some form. Okay. So then the Prophet used to start his open calling now. Okay. So for 3 years, the calling is in hiding, basically, in secret temple. Then he goes out and he starts to call his people, basically. And he goes out and the first people he calls are Bani Hashim, his own tribe, essentially. Okay. Then he goes on, and we know the famous incident where he gathers the people and he says to them, if I was to tell you that there was an army coming from over the mountain, would you believe me? And they said yes. You've never lied about this small thing, you're not going to lie about a huge thing, it's impossible. Okay? He said, O Bani Fahir, O Bani Adi, two tribes from Al-Quraysh, and Abu Lahab was present. You see, they said, yes, we've only witnessed the truth from you. He said, I'm a warner to you before a severe torment. So I'm basically tells about Tawheed. Abu Lahab says, perish you this day, have you summoned us for such a thing? So Abu Lahab, his own uncle, betrays him at this time, and Tabbatida Abila Habiyu is revealed at this time, basically. So this story is revealed. Why? Because his uncle, is really bad in this sense. And so the Prophet continues to warn the people. So he continues, and he goes out, and he openly calls the people to Islam. But the Quraysh, they don't know what to do. Okay? Then they have one person, and Quran is revealed about what he does, and he starts to think about how we're going to describe the Prophet ﷺ. So who is this man? Who is the one who gathers together, and he's the one who's going to think, Rasulullah is this, that, who's the man? Walid al-Mughira, basically, yeah? He's the father of Khalid ibn Walid. So this is quite important. Again, you see how it's all about family here, isn't it? Khalid ibn Walid, one of the greatest of Pandya, his father, one of the greatest of idolaters, okay? So, Quran says in Surah 74, verse 18-25, very much detailed. Verily, about Walid al-Mughira. Verily, he thought and plotted, so let him be cursed. How he plotted, and once more, let him be cursed, how he plotted. Then he thought, then he frowned, and he looked in a bad-tempered way. Then he turned back and was proud. And then he said, this is nothing but magic from that of old. This is nothing but the words of a human being. Look at the Quran detail. And Khalid ibn Walid must have recited these verses later on. Very difficult. Obviously, it's his father. Still his father, isn't it? So it's very hard. But obviously, these are the kind of verses that were revealed. Then we go on. And then we start, and we'll end here now, inshallah, just covering the tortures that were inflicted upon the Muslims at that time. Okay? So in terms of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how did they harm him? So not how did they harm his companions, how did they harm him? This one.
Just by people saying crazy.
Yeah. So they taunted him, they degraded him, they said the very bad words about him, basically. This is sometimes for an honourable person, this can be the worst thing. Because your honour is the most important thing that you possess. If people harm you, but your honour, your reputation, they call him a madman, they call him a liar, they call all of these kind of things, basically. Two of his daughter married two of the youth of Quraysh. They divorced them. You know, he had a son that died in infancy. They said to him that you are the one cut off from offspring. These are very powerful statements to make, particularly in these kind of cultures as well. And the one time that they particularly tried to harm him was we know when he was doing sujood in the precincts of the Kaaba. We all know this incident, don't we? When Abu Jahl is there, and Abu Jahl says to them, you know, who is the one who gets the worst of the animal meat and put it on the back of Rasulullah, which they do in front of all of the people, they're all laughing at him. Then his daughter Fatima, radiallahu anha, comes, takes it off him. So these are the way in which the Prophet was really harmed and abused in this time. They tried to kill him as well. We know Abu Bakr came to that incident. Why do you kill a man? He said, my lord is Allah. Amongst their companions then, you know, who were the ones that were really, really oppressed and tortured?
Bilal,
yeah. Because Bilal, the people that had a tribe, they were tortured less. So if you take Abu Bakr, brother Amr, he was harmed, they tried to harm him, they tried to kill him, but still, they knew there was a limit, because he had a tribe they were supporting. But people that particularly were slaves, they had no tribe, they were tortured the most. And Bilal, it goes down in the history that he was tortured so much. He was a slave of Umayyah bin Khalaf. He was severely beaten by his master when they came to know about his conversion to Islam. They would drag him through the streets and the hills of Mecca, and they would put a huge stone over him, and they would say, by Allah, I will not stop until you are dead, or until you reject Muhammad and worship Allah al-Uzza. Whilst Bilal was suffering, he would only say, Ahadun, Ahadun. You know, everyone, it's a very famous story, but it's very powerful, because you can be tortured, but you know there's a limit to it. You know someone, your tribe will come, or even the Prophet will come and let them support you. When you think you don't know anyone is coming, at that time to stand up against atrocity is, it really takes the iman, and this was the iman of Bilal. So it continues, we'll stop there inshallah, and we'll start looking at the pressure of Abu Talib and how the Muslims they react to this torture and torment. So this is the end of this small talk. Is there any questions or comments, particularly about what we have covered today inshallah? No? Jazakallah khair, subhanahu wa bihamdi, subhanahu wa bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Jazakallah khair for your time.